First time I noticed her was on a Wednesday night. We had this, it's like Jeopardy, while we were both in college. I really noticed her because she actually kept getting all the questions right. And it was girls against guys, and so she was pretty much slaughtering us.
Matt was a door greeter, and one day after the lesson Sunday night, he kind of chased me down. I was in my car, and he ran to the door, and he asked me if I would like to go out with him.
I posted myself near the door, so as she was leaving, I could introduce myself and say hi.
So was there a desperate flee to the parking lot to catch her in the car?
Yeah, so, yeah, obviously you've talked to Rachel.
I'm wide awake, I'm wide awake. Don't know how much more I can take. And soon the sun will bring the day.
You got loose tooth? Oh, that's a blood.
I'm wide awake, I'm wide awake.
We're probably your typical household with four kids. So we've got Ethan, who's 13, Lauren, who's 10, Bryce, who's 8, and then Caleb is our youngest 6-year-old. So, yeah, you.
Lord, so we need to serve your son's name.
Amen.
All right, more tortilla.
Oh, yeah. All right. Thanks.
My husband's an engineer by trade and a geologist.
I wish I could see your awards.
And so he's very, very technical, very analytically minded.
We won
this,
didn't we?
You gotta go. You're gonna be late.
Okay. I gotta roll. Bye, Ethan. We'll see you at the hospital, okay?
All right, man. He always thought Ethan, when he was little, that Ethan would be, you know, an engineer or something, just those spatial thinkers are. And I remember one day Matt came home from work, and I said, Matt, I really feel like he's going to be a preacher one day. And Matt said, I'm not getting that same feeling.
As long as they can see it.
You seem like you're in a pretty good mood this morning. What has you in such a good mood?
I guess I'm happy I get to go to school. That's real. It's fun.
It's kind of a different attitude than a lot of kids have.
I guess.
Why do you think you can say school is fun?
Because I don't get to go that often.
Hey, guys! Hey! Shh! Good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming out. This is almost our last I Am Second. We'll have one more next Wednesday.
What's up, big pudding pants? Stop, halt, turn, face, smile. Such a clown.
My shirt.
And this one is pretty special. We have a special guest coming.
Last year, we had a prayer meeting for anyone who wanted to come in and pray for Ethan, as he was going to be going through some pretty big tests and treatment.
Ethan is going to have his own I Am Second video made about him, and y'all are invited to come. So yeah, he's going to have his own video.
And I think about that same time that some things were going on in some of our youth groups here, and it sparked a new fire amongst a lot of our seventh graders.
He gives us through the daily lives and everything we do, Lord. Be with his family, give them strength and courage, Lord, to go through the day and to just know you are with
them. And it's just grown.
Thank you for Ethan, and please help him to stay strong. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Matt, could you tell me what happens in a conversation when the word cancer is spoken?
Yeah. Whenever we kind of bring it up or mention it, it's a bit of a conversation killer. And a lot of people are very afraid of that, afraid of the thought. They can't even handle hearing about kids having cancer. You know, much less, you know, being in the same room as a kid that has cancer or whose father has a kid who has cancer. They just don't know how to handle it.
I think you're gonna be 8.6 based on your color.
The eyes feel kind of heavy. The eyelids.
Oh no, I go down to 8.4 then. The one who gets it closer has to buy another one of tea.
What? I want a slush.
I'll buy you a slush. You buy me a tea.
There we go. 8.7.
What? That's like pretty much what I said.
You said 8.3.
That's only incrementally bigger.
Exactly.
Fine, it's whoever's closest. It'll be in tens of points.
So, Ethan's got sympathetic nerve cell cancer, and currently he has what they call metastasized disease, which means that it's spread to different parts of his body. But in his bone, in the hard bone, he's got disease in his right forearm, in his left upper arm, his two spots in his right knee. He has a large spot in his greater trochanter, which is his upper left leg. He's got a soft tissue tumor that's about the size of an egg that is right behind his heart. And it fingers out to go around his spine and then up about 4 or 5 vertebrae in his back. And that's probably the biggest sleeping giant that there is. But if that isn't enough, there's a couple tumors in his abdomen as well.
These 20 days of radiation will make over 100 days, about 100 days total since he was diagnosed, that he's had some form of radiation, whether to his arm, he's had it to his neck, to his original tumor in his abdomen. So he's had extensive radiation. He's 13, and I'm gonna be 38 tomorrow, you know? And, you know, my son's gonna be radiated on my birthday. But, you know, he was, two years ago, he was in San Francisco and got a horrific full body liquid radiation on my birthday. And this year he's getting external beam radiation. And you know, it's horrific, but I can't complain because I don't know if he'll be here next year on my birthday. So, you know, we'll. We'll just be glad he's here. You know, we'll rejoice tomorrow. It's gonna be a day of celebration with a little radiation along the way. So.
They say we're going on fire. Say we're everything they want but just can't find.
They see what they need or they see what they like. It's hard to breathe being held this high.
Hey, who's that, Christian? Hey, okay. Netherlands versus Spain.
Oh, I know these guys. That's Van Persie, Sergio Ramos,
PK. That can't be Van Persie. That's nine.
Ramos. That's Van Persie.
He was eight.
He's nine.
He's eight. My dad has his jersey. Yeah.
He's nine right now.
How this much is it for now.
Want to bet candy?
Let's see when this is.
Want to bet candy?
Hold on.
Bet you candy. Come on, look at this.
Well, I have forgotten how to cry. That's what drove the Mongols to it. That's what drove those Mongols to it.
We go. One piece down, like 500 to go.
I did.
Good job, guys.
Precious says your mom will do it. She said my mom will do it if she don't.
About 6.5 years ago, Ethan was riding a scooter and he came over to me and played wiffle ball, and then we became friends. We started going over to each other's houses like every day.
Look me in the eye and see your everything I need.
Hippie.
Somebody hit him.
That's just what I need. Just take some comfort in the cards I have. All of this best yourself. Don't make such a mess.
Probably like the only boy that I know that would actually hold a shark that's trying to bite him. When we went to Matagorda, he caught the first shark. It was a black tip, and he held it. And I was the one in the back who was scared of the shark.
You just had one of those moments where you forgot what you did.
Yep.
It pretty much happens to me every day in my life.
Where am I?
Oh yeah, the hospital.
Have you guys noticed a change in Ethan since his diagnosis?
Yes.
What was that? What was that change?
He became a lot closer to God. And every time we go eat with him, Ethan is the one who prays. Normally, he's never like the one that prayed. And it just changed his life practically.
While you guys are facing this cancer together, have you also changed?
That year that he got diagnosed, I started becoming more closer to God. And that couple months later, I accepted Christ and I was baptized. So it changed my life after.
What specifically caused you to make that decision?
I thought Ethan was a symbol that God is not dead, he's alive. That he's moving through people to show that he is alive.
One day in June of 2010, we took the kids on vacation to the beach. And on the road home, I felt it multiple times. God was saying, you're about to go through a storm, but I'm about to meet you there. I'm gonna meet you in it, and I'm gonna walk you through it. So the next day, Ethan had severe tummy pain and got into the doctor, tried some meds. He played a baseball game the next day and the meds weren't working. And so the next day they were able to get him in for a CT. And I have the kids all lotioned up that day. We're gonna go to Six Flags after. We go over to the local hospital. It's very small. They call him back. What's taking so long? This technician comes out. She said, you need to go back over to your pediatrician's office. They're waiting for you. So well, he can just call me because we need to go to Six Flags. No, he's waiting for you. He needs to see you. No, I'm sorry. I've already promised he's gets Six Flags. He can call me with the information. And she said, ma'am, I don't think you understand. You need to go back to your doctor. He's waiting for you. We go in, and I sign in at the front desk, and a door, there's a door down the hallway, and the door opens. And I remember looking left, and the doctor, who's about the same age as I am, I catch it, he's standing there at the physician's desk, and I see him turn his head and look at me, and when he did, he looked down immediately, and because he couldn't look at me. When they called us back, they took my four kids and me into a room, and the nurse said, I'm gonna take all the kids out. And I'm thinking, well, why are you taking Ethan out? He's the patient. So the doctor, I'm standing up at this point, and he pulls a chair for me, and he pulls a chair for him, because he can't stand to tell me this news. And he says, sit down. I said, that's all right. He goes, I need you to sit down. So I sat, and he started to shake a little bit. And so then my heart is racing. I said, Ethan has a mass in his abdomen. And he goes, and it's big. And I can't even remember what else he said, because when the word cancer came out of his mouth, I had to get far away from him and from the room. And I remember stumbling to my knees, running out into the hallway, and I wanted my children. And I was screaming for them and wanting them. My kids are somewhere safe in a private room so that they won't see the overwhelming grief of their mother. And I was just in utter shock. And people say, always tell me all the time, God will never give you more than you can handle. But I can say in that moment, it was far more than I could handle. In the days that followed, we learned it wasn't a lymphoma. We learned it was neuroblastoma. And it wasn't just neuroblastoma. It was stage 4, high risk of relapse, unfavorable histology, neuroblastoma. And it was in his bone marrow. It was in his abdomen. And he was very old to have the disease. And we couldn't even find many older survivors to encourage us. And we had a doctor sit with us and say, you know, at his age, the odds are really stacked against him. And realistically, you know, most kids have about a 50% chance of surviving neuroblastoma. But your son probably has, if I had to say, probably closer to 20% because of his age. He left the room. Matt and I are just looking at each other and, wait, how did we go from him having a 80% chance of surviving to now an 80% chance of dying? It was more than as a mother I could handle in the moment, and my body was wrought with grief to the point that breathing felt difficult. And Matt got up, and all he could do was just hit the wall, sobbing and hitting the wall. And I've got my head thrown into the bed that's in that room. And we had to collect ourselves because we had to go tell our son what he would be facing. You know, nine years old. And his dad's on one side of his bed, and I'm sitting on the bed. And he looks at me and he said, I do have cancer, right? And I said, yes, buddy, you do. And he took his arms and he just goes. You know, I would just sit outside his doorway and cry and cry and cry. And I felt like if I cried enough, God would make the tumor go away, would make his bone marrow become healthy again. But he felt a million miles away.
gosh.
No, I threw him right at the roof. No!
That's
what
I get 5 shirts.
Yeah, they get
5 shirts. No. Oh. No, that's not the base. The white thing is base, Caleb.
Oh, my.
He's safe. That doesn't count.
He's safe. He didn't know what the base was.
That was great.
Do you have a fear that is related to Ethan?
If he did go to heaven, that I just stop following God because he killed my best friend, that like he wasn't real, because like Ethan died, but we know that he will be going to a place where we will be going one day, a better place.
So the two things that we do have experience with would be, one is serenity can, which I already know where you're going with that. I see your wheels spinning. And the other is vrenostat.
Today was sort of a typical day in Ethan's clinic visit. He's got a tumor that's pushing on nerves that's behind his heart and in front of his spinal cord. And so we've had to start radiation treatment on him for that. But the downside to that radiation treatment is it doesn't touch any of the other cancer that's in his body. So we were meeting with the doctor to talk about what options do we have that maybe we can combine with the radiation, so that hopefully we can keep sort of the other cancer in check and just keep, slow it down, the growth.
Do you need to lay down?
Just stay awake at least to this.
I know.
You can sleep afterwards.
It's been over 2 years ago that Ethan had his first relapse. And at that point, then they told us there's no hope. His chances are zero. And so every day since then, we pray for God's grace just to intervene and to cure him. But God's answer has been, you know, I'm going to allow you to just be with him. And every day is a blessing. The focus certainly changed from, you know, let's cure him, to let's find something that gives him really good quality of life. And we cherish every day. That's it.
Sometimes people, you know, when they talk about Ethan in regards to, you know, life and death, and that he might not beat this disease, and, you know, that science says by all means he's not going to beat the disease, that, you know, I should take comfort in the fact that, you know, he has brought people to Christ. And, you know, I do take comfort in that, but it still doesn't change the fact that I don't want to lose my son. As a mother and a human, you know, the thought of Ethan dying, the thought of losing Ethan,
You sort of have these moments when you ask God, and, you know, why my son? You know, why can't you use this in a different way? Not being angry at God, but just wishing he would take it away. And, God answered me, and in that moment, it was a moment that was really crystal clear. Sometimes, you know, God's voice is just really distant, and you just
Don't know if you even hear it. But at that time, it was really crystal clear. God said, how dare you question my love for him? Because that's what I was doing. I was questioning, you know, how can you let my son endure this? You know? How can loving, omnipotent God allow a kid that's 9 years old to go through this suffering? Because how could I, as a father, just, you know, I would give anything. I would give anything to take it away. But God had a different plan, and God just said, how dare you? He said, he's only your son temporary. He's my son forever. And how could I even ask him that question? Because God loves him so much more than I do. And so I knew at that point, you know, God does love him so much more. So much more. If he could send his son to die, how much does he love my son? And so since then, ever since then, I've never questioned. Because when I put my love for my son compared to God's love for my son, it doesn't even match up. It's not even close. Because my love is so small compared to his love. And I never ask him again, how could I?
Wait. Stay here and have a drink of time. Wait before you split yourself in two. There's time for you. But if you travel here, you will feel at home. The brightest sound. If you travel here, listen to your heart and take with you what lasts forever.
How many medicines do you have to take every day, Ethan?
On a normal day, 5.
5 different medicines?
Mm-hmm. These two help me feel hungry. If I don't take this, my arm kind of swells up because there's disease there too. This is just for heartburn because chemo gives you heartburn. Hot water and cold water feel like don't feel good. And so this kind of makes my nerves work how they're supposed to.
I think the life that they're living through is the anti-American dream, in that their family is thriving in the midst of this unbelievable suffering. Suffering, I mean, you look at the divorce rate in families of cancer, and it's astronomically high. This is a disease that destroys people. Not only the individuals that have cancer, but it destroys families that deal with cancer because it's such a horrendous disease.
I made the whole thing.
I already did this.
But in a crazy way, they're thriving in this. like the love that they have for each other and the way that this family has bonded together and rallied around each other is not only countercultural, I mean, it's counterintuitive.
You've heard it said, Roy, that it takes a village to raise a kid. It takes a lot more than that to get one fight through cancer. And Ethan's story is y'all's story. Thank you guys so much.
So these are called the beads of courage. Dang, why do these things have to be so tangly? Dad, you wanna come here and help me? Oh man, Mom would throw a fit if she saw this black one with fish. Katie, now we're cooking with peanut oil. All these ones with the color in them, those are for radiation. And they actually glow in the dark. So it's pretty cool. The blacks mean pokes. And I think we counted them last night. It was like 400 something pokes over 4 years, like needle sticks.
When you look at all these beads, would you say that you feel courageous?
No, not really courageous. Well, I used to play baseball a lot. Used to be pretty much addicted to it. Live and breathe it, I guess. Come home after school and throw the ball at a wall from 2:45 to 6 o'clock when dinner was. But I guess that year, it was kind of different. Stomach started hurting, I guess. Even when I was sitting at my desk in school, playing with my friends. It got really bad when the All-Star season started, I guess. And I was playing center field. And our pitcher threw one right down the middle. And you could see the kid nail it. And I was just bending over, hoping he wouldn't hit it towards me because my stomach hurt so bad. It was making my legs hurt even. And sure enough, he hits it right towards me. And I'm like, oh no, don't want to go get this ball. And so I started backpedaling because I didn't want to, you know, let my team down. And my back hit the fence and I was like, oh, I don't even think I meant to reach my arm up there. It was just like accidentally flew up there. And I caught it. And I remember it like jerking my arm back and I was like, oh, I hope that paid off. That hurt so bad. And I caught it, but I didn't really care that much about catching it because my stomach and legs hurt so bad. All the other kids ran back to the dugout and I just walked. More like limped, probably. And I just remember my friend's dad, one of my good friend's dads, yelling, "That's how you play baseball?" He was one of our assistant coaches. And I just walked right past him. I mean, my stomach hurts so bad. And then the next day, they did the biopsy and they found out it was a stage 4 neuroblastoma. Didn't really know what that was, but I knew it was cancer, but I didn't really know what cancer was either, but I knew it was bad, but I didn't know how bad. So my life pretty much started changing right there. There's no more baseball, no more school. You gotta get a port, you're gonna lose your hair, gonna lose all your energy. Didn't know this really at the beginning, but learned, I guess. So we started, I think, 6 rounds of chemo, just going. It was time to
take that tumor out. I didn't really know that he was gonna cut me from, like, literally side to side. I mean, it's huge. How does anyone walk after having their gut cut open? Then what he did, a stem cell transplant, my tongue, the skin on my tongue would peel off in long flakes. Even my eyelids had sores. It was awful. Antibodies. Sounds pretty easy, but it's not. I guess I was hitting my hands and saying, make it stop, but I don't remember that. Just waking up and going, oh man, I don't want to do this. Incredibly hard, really dark. That's when I found it was back for a second time. And I could hear my mom as she collapsed and cried, started crying. I had nightmares for a while, actually. My arm is broken. They said it's not gonna heal back. I was isolated in a room with no one else. It's how radioactive you are. NK, a natural killer cell. By far the worst treatment ever done. Your whole body feels like it's on fire, and it feels like you're laying on a bed of nails, and you're going through it, not on top of it. And it's still nothing. I guess then it was kind of when we decided no more of this incredibly hard treatment. 4 years and it's still nothing. I mean, obviously, I want to beat this disease, but I'm not going to be that sad if I don't. Of course, I want to live long life on Earth. Who doesn't? It's not really my plan, though. Psalms 40, verse 5 is probably my favorite verse. It says, many are the wonders you have done, Lord God. The things you have planned for us, nothing can compare. None can compare with you. If I were to count your mercies, they would outnumber the sands on the seashore. I know it's kind of weird that my favorite verse is mercies and whatnot. But it's true. Even though this cancer's had a lot of bad stuff, there's not been a lot of good stuff. I met friends that I would have never met. One friend I know has come to Christ just because I played with him. He's up there right now. I've grown closer to God. Family has. I wouldn't trade my relationship with Jesus for anything. Nothing at all. This is something I've written to my brothers and sister and my friends. I don't know if y'all know it, but I have seen the true love of God through all y'all. Times it felt like God was far away, but he was right there in you. Keep putting your faith in God and always remember that he is with you, and even in the depths of suffering, he's good. Love you guys.
This justice phone of memory of gold and silver tears, I'd give you more to own than all this. Oh, I'd give you more than years.
My son said, I know I'm in a lot of darkness right now, but I've come to learn that the greatest amount of darkness, just the smallest amount of light, will overcome it.
Ethan's made a huge impact here at our school. A lot of his best friends are spiritual giants here at our school. I don't see that much in a seventh grader.
You know, it got me thinking. You know, I even started my own IM second group in my high school, and I mean, that's just blowing up now.
He has taught me to never give up hope on anything.
There's a couple guys in our church right now who are struggling with cancer. These are guys that are in their mid-50s, in their mid-60s, and Ethan has been just somebody of impact for them, you know, 13-year-old kid.
In my family, my dad was diagnosed with cancer, and my mom, she chose to deal with it, not to run to God, but really chose to run to drugs. And so just seeing Ethan when he ran to God in a situation, it just really inspired me that God's grace is sufficient. It's sufficient for Ethan, it's sufficient for me.
You're not alone. You're now a part of me. You feel the cure. I feel the soul.
Even if I do pass away from cancer, and be focused on the goal, and when I get there, even if it's soon, hope to kneel before him and hear him say, hopefully hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. My name is Ethan Hallmark, and I'm second.
I will carry